Well, no matter who you are, we're so glad you're here. Would you stand with us? Hold your hands out like this as a way of receiving from the Lord. We're going to say this together. I'm not what I do. I'm not what I have. I'm not what people say about me. I am the beloved of God. It's who I am. No one can take it from me. I don't have to worry. I don't have to hurry. I can trust my friend Jesus and share his love with the world. We are so excited to welcome our guest speaker today. Mike Erre is a pastor and author who has published 5 inspirational books. He's pastored several churches here in Orange County, including Mariners, Rock Harbor, and EV Free Fullerton. Mike currently serves as the teaching pastor at Journey Church in Franklin, Tennessee. He's an amazing preacher. You're going to love this sermon. I want to encourage you to listen to the whole thing. Please welcome with me Mike Erre.
Well, good morning, brothers and sisters, after that intro. No pressure, right? And I want to thank the one person that clapped initially. I don't know who that was. But may Jesus bless you, especially this morning. My name is Mike. I'm delighted to be with you. We were out here in Southern California for 20 years. I'm originally from Ohio. Moved back to the Midwest, and we miss so much about Southern California. But it's just great to be with you. I wanted to reflect a little bit on the reading that Pastor Chad did from Ephesians, where Paul talks about what was true of us apart from Christ and what's true of us now because of his great mercy. This is something that Paul does throughout his letters. He's very, very intentional about always beginning his letters with the declaration of what Jesus has done for us, for those in Christ, before he ever gets into what we must do in response. Theologians call this pattern the indicative and then the imperative. The indicative, Paul talks in the indicative sense. He's indicating what it is that Jesus has done for us. And you see this in Romans and Galatians and other places, but you particularly see it in Ephesians. The first 3 chapters are nothing but Paul indicating what it is that Christ has done. There's only one command, one imperative in the whole section, and that's just the imperative to remember. Then what Paul does is he will often say, okay, in light of all that Jesus has done, here's what we are invited to do. So the indicative is the first part. The imperative is what we must do in response. And it's super important to notice that order because Paul doesn't reverse it. Moralism says, all right, you must do this in order to receive this. Gospel says, no, you've received this. Now, here's how you respond to what it is that you've already received. And so I want to summarize briefly the first 3 chapters of Ephesians by just highlighting the things that Paul has said about what we used to be apart from Christ and what we are now in Christ. So Diane, let's fire up the slides together. Here we go. Apart from Christ, dead in transgressions and sins, following the ways of the world, ruled by the ruler of the kingdom of the air, enslaved to the cravings and desires of our sinful nature, objects of wrath separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope, without God, far away, no identity as a people. In Christ, we're blessed with every spiritual blessing, chosen before the creation of the world. We are saints, we are holy, we are blameless, we're brought near, we're fellow citizens, we're adopted as sons and daughters. We're given grace, we're saved, redeemed, and forgiven. We're the dwelling place of God's Spirit. We're members of God's household. We're predestined, we're included in Christ, sealed by the Holy Spirit, recipients of God's lavish grace, recipients of God's glorious inheritance, building blocks of God's temple. We're raised with Christ, seated with Christ, alive with Christ. We're God's workmanship, members of a new humanity, and we all now in Christ have access to the Father. And that sounds like good news, wouldn't you agree? So for three chapters, and this is Paul's normal pattern, he just says, here's what Jesus has done. But he will often give a transition into what we must do that's really important. In the book of Ephesians, he gives one of his best transitions. The first three chapters are nothing but indicating what Jesus has done, only one command to remember. Then in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1, Paul lays one of these transitions on us that really shapes them the rest of the letter. He says, as a prisoner for the Lord then, I urge you to live a life, and then what's the text say? What's the next word? Worthy of the calling that you have, what? Received, past tense. So what's the calling we've received? Well, we just read it, right? Sentence after sentence, word after word of what it is that Jesus has done. Then Paul pivots, as a prisoner for the Lord, then I urge you to live a life worthy. Now, this word worthy is really important because you can hear that one of two ways. Worthy could mean, hey, look at all that Jesus did. Be worthy of his sacrifice. Pay it back, if you will. Deserve it or earn it in some way. And I'm reminded of Saving Private Ryan. Have any of you seen that movie, Tom Hanks movie years ago? A few of us. My wife, the only reason my wife watched it was because Matt Damon was in it. And that's when we got married. She said there was a resemblance between Matt Damon and myself. I'm not going to argue. She also doesn't have very good eyesight, but don't tell her. Tom Hanks plays a captain of a squad of soldiers that come ashore on D-Day. It's just brutally filmed and shot. And it gives you a sense of, oh my goodness, what this must have been like. And after that initial conflict, they kind of enter into into France more deeply, and they get strange orders. Their job is to go rescue another American soldier and send him home. Turns out this Private Ryan character, played by Matt Damon, is the youngest of four sons. The other three sons have died in the war. And so the secretary of the army has said, no, we're not sending another, letter home to mom announcing the death of her last son. So Tom Hanks' squad was tasked with finding Private Ryan, rescuing him out of the conflict and sending him home. The Tom Hanks character gets mortally wounded in the conflict. I don't know if you remember the scene. It's kind of an amazing scene. As Tom Hanks is dying, he pulls Matt Damon close. The Matt Damon character, and he says, earn this sacrifice. Five of his men, including himself, have died for this guy. Earn this. And then the story fast forwards. I don't know if you remember, but it's an elderly Private Ryan now standing over the grave of the Tom Hanks character, and he's weeping. He turns to his wife and he says, please tell me that I've been a good man. In other words, please tell me that I was worthy of such sacrifice. And you realize, earn it wasn't some invitation to freedom and joy. Earn it kind of hung over his whole life as he was trying to pay back something that could never be repaid. So the word worthy, like instead of saying live a life paying this back or live a life earning this, Paul says, no, live a life fitting to the calling you've already got. Live a life that corresponds to what's already true of you. Become, in other words, who you already are. It's already true of you. So live into that reality. Now that's kind of like, okay, great theory. What does that actually mean? Well, it turns out we do this all the time. Like marriage is a great example of this. I got married when I was 29. And I think you'll agree, it's shocking I lasted that long. Right? I mean, we can all agree about that, right? Not a lot of smiles over here. A lot of like, no, I can totally see. I'm shocked you got married at all. I can totally see that. Understand, and my wife may rethink her choices every now and again. But married at 29, Left the house at 18. So I had 11 years of living a life fitting for a bachelor. And it was glorious. I mean, and I don't, I know I'm going to get judged for this. It's okay. This is a safe place. But like laundry, all right, I had three piles on the floor. Clean, worn once but wearable, and then unclean, if you know what I'm saying. Now the problem was, and I knew it was time to do laundry when there was just one pile. That was always a sure sign. But I know some of the ladies are looking at me like, really? Oh, it gets worse. It absolutely gets worse. You know how sometimes when you don't do dishes right away and you let them soak, sometimes there are things that grow? I didn't realize that. So every now and again, I would just buy all new pots and pans because I'd let things soak too long. And I thought, you know, okay, that's fine. Right? I mean, I lived a life worthy of bachelorhood. I didn't have to check in with anybody. I didn't have to ask permission to anybody. I just lived this sort of selfish life. And then in July of 2000, I walk into a church and the pastor looks at me and says, I pronounce you a husband. Now, do I have any idea what it means to be a husband? Ladies? Nope, not even remotely. But all of a sudden, I am one. And the rest of my married life is spent learning to be the husband I already am. And so the invitation is to put off all of those ways of thinking and living and relating that were appropriate to me as a bachelor and put on all those ways of thinking and relating and speaking that are appropriate to me now as a husband. Does that make sense? This is what Paul means when he says, live a life worthy. You've been called and identified as one of Jesus's people. Now live a life according to what's already true of you. Or think about parenthood, for those of you that are parents or grandparents. You show up to a hospital as a couple, and you leave with this beautiful, fragile creature. And you have no idea, right? You have no idea. Yes, a beautiful, fragile creature right here, yes. And we have no idea what to do with you. But the rest of our life is learning to be the parent we already are. See, the image isn't, hey guys, you're saved by grace and then you're on your own. The image is, no, grace follows you the whole way because you have it all already. Now live up to what's already true. And it's the security of my marriage that allows me to be imperfect. It's the security of my bond with my child that allows me to be imperfect, right? I am a husband. Whether or not I'll be a good one is up for debate. I am a father. Whether or not I'll be a good one is up to debate. But I cannot get away from that reality. It's true of me no matter what. And so when Paul begins three chapters worth of here's what Jesus has done, and then says, as a prisoner for the Lord, I urge you to live a life fitting to that. That's the image he gives us. It's from grace to grace to grace. The most powerful example of this that I've heard of from a friend was a buddy of mine was in grad school studying philosophy, I believe it was, at USC. Sitting there, a very famous Christian named Dallas Willard, who was a philosophy professor at SC. And in his graduate work, my friend was told one day, Dallas came to him and said, listen, I am going to give you an A on the next paper you write. Write a paper worthy of an A. And when he said that, my jaw hit the floor. I thought of this text and I was like, so could you have just gotten a blank sheet of paper and wrote, to Dallas, love Steve, here's my paper. Would you have still gotten an A? And he said, yeah. The A was guaranteed. I said, but what did you do? Like, how did you approach it? He said, it was the best paper I've ever written. Why? Because I wasn't afraid of being graded. I knew I'd already passed. imagine the freedom if we actually believed that your life grades out as an A. It already is. It's going to be imperfect bumps and bruises, hills and valleys, but it's going to grade out an A. You got an A. So write a paper with your life worthy of the A that you've received. Imagine if we dared to believe that all of this is true, how freely we would love and how freely we would give and how freely we might live life in the face of so much anxiety and fear and turmoil. If Jesus' people actually thought this is the way it works, that God really is for us and not against us, and we just run from grace to grace to grace to more grace, we might actually resemble the Jesus we supposedly follow. Because for me, I still think the old rules apply. Yes, I'm saved by grace, but I've got to do this in order to receive this. That's not the picture Paul paints. You're a spouse, so be the spouse you already are. You're a parent, be the parent you already are. Your paper's already been graded, so write a paper worthy of the grade you've already got. I find that to be good news. I don't know about you. And this is what is so different about the gospel than any other kind of religious system in the world. It's given to us up front in virtue of our association with Jesus, and then it's worked out over time, not in some earn it and prove it way, but rather in the context of a covenant relationship where, yes, there are ups and downs, but progressively I'm looking more and more like what it is that's supposedly true of me. But this is hard for us. I don't know about you. I can say that I'm beloved of God, or I can hear some of this great theory, but very often I have an inherited identity that's just so at odds with the words that I hear from Jesus. You know, maybe I was the rebellious kid way back when, or maybe I was the successful kid and the workaholic kid, or maybe I was the sports person, or whatever it is, from coaches and parents and siblings and spouses, we kind of have an inherited identity that we live into and live out. And part of the work of Jesus is the putting off of that old self and putting on the new, right? Paul himself says, if anyone is in Christ, new creation has come. So we might be able to hear all of this, but it's kind of hard for us to really believe. That's why Paul speaks of salvation in three tenses. He never just speaks of being saved. Go ahead, Diane, if you would. Notice he speaks of it in all three tenses. We have been saved, we are being saved, and we what? We'll be saved. Why is that? Because it's true, but we're slowly working it out. So for us, as recipients of this grace, there should be this incredible permission and joy to live a life worthy of the A. But also, as we do this as a community, who are we as grace recipients to sit in judgment of other people who are receiving grace themselves? That's one of the hardest things about grace. Grace levels us. It's hard to judge people when you're operating on grace, right? Just like everybody else is. I mean, and saints, the old saying is, burn grace like cars burn gasoline. If you've ever been to a support group, a 12-step group, one of the things that people find so compelling about them is they know what waits for them when they show up. And that's grace and understanding. Honesty, yes, of course. But people who have been there and get it. And so often in the world, the church of Jesus isn't known for the grace that we've claimed for ourselves, but restrict then to who else can receive it. So the invitation of Jesus, the invitation of Paul, is not just to become what's already true of us, but to give people space into their lives to do it too. That's the much harder bit. And so for us, maybe you've heard this, maybe this is super familiar, but there's a sense in which we have to have a kind of view of the Father and his relationship to us that's different often than the one I've typically thought of. Because God in this view, is loving us into our future, gracing us into our future. And as he's doing that, he's patiently with us as we, in fits and starts, try to grow into what's already true. Years ago, acquaintances of ours adopted a child from the foster care system. And that child, they noticed after a couple of weeks, they would find in the child's bedroom little stashes of food in bags, under the mattress, under the bed, behind the curtains, just little bitty stashes of food. And obviously they were very puzzled by this. And initially the child didn't want to say anything about why that was the case. But after weeks and months went by, they discovered the reason this kid hid food was because his biological parents would punish him by starving him over the course of a weekend by locking him in his room without food for a weekend. And so kids are resilient, right? And so what did he learn to do? Hide food in his room. It was a matter of survival. And so, of course, when he arrives into a new family, what's the thing that's most natural? To do the same thing. Now imagine you're the father or mother who has adopted this child into your home. What are your feelings towards this child? Are you angry at the child for hiding food? Are you? Boy, not at all. I mean, if there's anger, it's probably towards the biological parents who would punish a kid this way. But what are your emotions towards this kid? I would imagine compassion, understanding. I get why you do that. And if you were the adoptive mother or father, what would you say to this child? What would you say? I mean, I can imagine saying something like, listen, my son, this family is not like your old family. We will never, ever starve you. You never have to hide food. Wouldn't we all say that? And do you think that child would believe it right away? No way. No way. Those are just words. So as a parent, what do you have to do in that moment? Three meals plus snacks every day. Day after day after day after weeks and months and years. How many meals do you think you have to provide? How many errors does the child have to make before he realizes he's not going to be punished that way anymore? How much time does growing into being a part of a new family take? And I just find that such a fitting picture of what it is that we're talking about here in Ephesians. That the Father looks at us still hiding food. It doesn't matter if we followed Jesus for 3 months or for 30 years. We're still afraid. We're still using crutches. We're still operating in a world with scarcity at the forefront of our minds. We're hiding food, and I imagine the Father looking at us the way you might look at that adoptive kid. You don't have to hide food anymore. I will provide for you. But do we believe it? Not at first. And so how many times do we come to the Lord's table? How many times do we sing songs that he is good? How many times do we see him answer prayer? How many times does the community gather to testify to his goodness? How many meals must we have until we get to the place where we dare to believe the good news is actually this good? That your life has graded out and you're safe. There's no condemnation. God is for you. I know we know all the words, but imagine being that little kid learning, I don't have to hide food anymore. And that, friends, is what Christ invites us into. Hallelujah for salvation in heaven. Hallelujah for forgiveness of sins. But even now, his salvation presses into us and works its way out so that we might live the air we've already got. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we bless you, and we ask for the courage and grace to believe that you're this good. Not as some matter of religious cliche or abstract theology, but to the depths of us that we might believe that grace awaits us every step of the way. Father, we pray that you would give us courage to put away all the ways that we cope and manage life, and to put off all of those ways of living and acting that are appropriate for people who don't worship you, that we might put on the ways of living and acting and being in the world that are fitting. But we need your help, we need your grace. We pray that we would become a community that just looks and acts and talks like Jesus of Nazareth, not only for our own benefit, but for the benefit of the world. Because it's in the name of Jesus our Christ we pray. Amen and amen. Thank you so very much.
Thank you for joining us in worship today. As we emerge from a long season of being separated from each other, we now realize that the simple act of gathering with loved ones is something we cannot take for granted. It truly nourishes our souls and is such a pure and godly gift.
Jesus loved to gather with people at big celebrations like weddings or smaller gatherings like lunch or dinner. It was at these gatherings that he would minister to folks from every background, from the elite to the sinners, and he would heal and redeem them.
At Hour of Power, we care about your journey with Christ and your entry back into the abundance the Lord has to offer when we gather with loved ones.
Psalm 36, 7 and 8 says, "How priceless is your unfailing love, O God. People take refuge in the shadow of your wings. They feast on the abundance of your house. You give them drink from your river of delights." Our Savior welcomes each of us to taste his blessings and to drink of his delights. And this is what Our Power is all about. By helping us take the gospel message around the globe, you enable millions to feast on the wonders of the Lord's goodness from the comfort of their own homes. To help you plan your next gathering and to make your entertaining a little easier, we've created a unique offer just for you.
Call, write, or go online today and request the Gather Here complete charcuterie set. Included in this set is a bamboo cutting and display board, a 4-piece cheese knife set, and our 40-page charcuterie recipes and tips book called Gather Here, Charcuterie for Family and Friends. We're asking for your gift of just $75 or more for all three items.
Friends, your faithfulness to our ministry and your generosity is what makes Hour of Power possible and available to yearning hearts around the world. Thank you so much, and remember, as always, God loves you, and so do we. Church family, if you've enjoyed this sermon, remember to give it a thumbs up and let me know what ministered to you in the comments section. From all of us here at Hour of Power, God loves you, and so do we.